Amen. You may not realize it, we have been focusing on stories of David this summer, four times. Today, we catch the stories in 2 Samuel when the momentum is up and everything has come together and David is on his way. He's put the Philistines in their place. He's consolidated the country, impressively uniting the north and the south. And he's established a new capital in Jerusalem. And as we remember last Sunday, brought up the Ark of the Covenant in this great festive parade, signifying that we're dealing with more than David here, that God reigns with his people. And David takes his place not as king in the usual sense, but as witness that God is king. But no sooner has God's sovereign rule been proclaimed by David than the clarity and the accuracy of that witness is threatened. And it comes from an unlikely quarter, from the very David who has given the witness. We pick up today 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 1 through 14. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be prince over my people in Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me."
The New Testament lesson this morning is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. "So then remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands, remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall that is the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed the peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It goes this way. In light of all he now has at his disposal, David wants to do something for God, God who has done so much for him. It makes sense. He wants to build God a sanctuary. He now had a home for himself. He would build a home for God. God had blessed him with a place of honor and had given him all the things a king could want. Now he was going to do something to God. He would bless God with a place of honor and repose. And so David goes and talks it over with his pastor, Nathan, the prophet Nathan. And Nathan was enthusiastic. Go, do all that is in your heart, for the Lord is with you. Now let me tell you that men and women in Nathan's position are used to being partners in asking God for help and rejoicing when that help comes that God gives. They aren't always used to having someone show up offering to do something for God. It's so unusual that when it happens, we want to immediately affirm it. We want to put our hands on it and bless it. It feels like such a breath of fresh air. And so the enthusiasm is immediate and uncritical. And so Nathan endorses David wholeheartedly, almost without thinking, it sounds like. I mean, what is there to think about? What grounds is there for suspicion? A house for God. You know, what could be better than that? But that night, God gave Nathan pause. God assessed David's proposal in quite a different light than Nathan did. It turns out that there were grounds for suspicion. Nathan went back to David in the morning and he withdrew the building permit. Now, pastors and lay leaders find themselves doing this sometimes, usually awkwardly. Why would you ever want to discourage a well-intended work for God? I mean, the intention is for God. Why would you throw a wet blanket on that kind of enthusiasm? All that energy ready to be poured into something great for God, and instead of affirming and guiding, say no. And I think the best answer, and the answer that comes out of today's lesson, is that there are times when our great human plans to do something for God are seen after a night of prayer to be a huge human distraction from what God is doing for us. That's what Nathan realized that night. I mean, God showed Nathan that David's building plans for God would interfere with God's building plans for David. God's word to David through Nathan was essentially this: you want to build me a house? Forget it. I'm going to build you a house. The kingdom that I'm shaping here isn't what you do for me, but what I do through you. I'm doing the building here, not you. I'm not going to let you confuse things by launching a building operation of your own. If I let you fill Jerusalem with sights and sounds of your building project, carpenters, hammers, and masons' chisels, and shouts of workers, before long, everyone will be caught up in what you are doing and not attended to what I am doing. Is that ringing too bad? Are you working on that? I may have a microphone on too bad. This is a kingdom that we're dealing with, and I am the king. I've gotten along without a so-called house all this time. Where did you come up with the idea that I need or want a house? If there's any building to be done, I'm doing it. And then God Yahweh reminds David through Nathan, I've been working with you since your shepherd days, building a kingdom, a place where salvation and justice and peace can be realized. That's why you're here today, to make visible and represent what I'm doing and to call attention, not to call attention to what you're doing. Now, you know the story. We've just come from this terrible failure of Saul and his kingship and leadership, and I think God is also saying, we're not going to have another one of those. There will come a time when it is appropriate for you to build something for me. Don't forget that, he's saying. In fact, he says, your son will do that. But this isn't the time. First, we have to get it into people's minds and hearts, the notion that my sovereignty comes first. Your kingship is a witness to my kingship. It should not obscure it. First things first. So that's the whole message that Nathan delivers to David. It's dominated, of course, by what God has done and what God is doing and what God will do. And what looked yesterday like this bold enterprise full of what David was going to be doing for God, today, well, it looks, you know, like in a big adventure and missing the point. It looks picayune. Now, do you know what I think? I think David is just about to cross over that line of being full of God to from being full of God to being full of David. And outwardly, everything is the same right now. He isn't conscious of doing anything different. He's not aware of any shift within, but something has shifted. Now, he's riding this great crest of acclaim. He's decisively defeated the opposition. He's united people, the north and the south, and he's captured the allegiance of Israel and Judah. And he's heading with that success about what he's going to do. And so he's in a position to do God a favor. In fact, the telltale verse may be this: see now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells in a tent. You see that implied comparison? A house of cedar versus it's better than God, that David has achieved a better standard of living than God, and from David's position of strength, he will do something significant for God. But if he continues along those lines, he will be ruined as God's king. Now consider this, my friends. It sounds strange, but it's true, and I bet as you reflect on your experience, you can affirm it. It is our seemingly good intentions that get us into the most grievous trouble. I mean, when we do wrong, usually we find out or we have some kind of check on that, and we know soon enough, and if our heart is anywhere near the right place, we find our way or work our way back into repentance, get back on track. But when we do good, there is always a space to feel good about ourselves as we receive the applause and the commendation from our leaders and friends. We usually begin, maybe not all at once, but after a while, begin to lose our sense of dependence upon God and always on our increasingly desperate need for grace, God's sovereign grace and help. And you know what Jesus said? In one of his stories about this, the last state of that person, he warned, is worse than the first. If any of us develop a self-identity in which God and God's actions are subordinated to us and our action, well, that's the beginning of our ruin as people of faith and as servants of God. And needless to say, there are moments. There's not a person here who doesn't need this. There are moments when we need a friend, a pastor, a prophet to step in and do for us what we're unlikely to do for ourselves. And so God speaks to Nathan, and Nathan speaks to David, and Nathan stops him in his tracks with this message. Now you've got it backwards. You won't build me a house. I'll make you a house. Now, we're in a much better place when we live out of what Isaac Bashevis Singer said, you know, I pray only when I'm in trouble, but I'm in trouble all the time, so I pray all the time. I mean, that is a safer place to be in. And actually, as you and I are about, loving, giving of ourselves in God's name, discerning the Spirit, following, faithfulness, you know, if we're in that place, usually we're not going to have too many times where we feel invulnerable because, you know, the Spirit just kind of leads us the next step out there. Like David up until this point, he didn't have time not to depend on God. And if there's too space of a long of a space of time and you don't feel that need, watch out. Watch out. Now Jesus said, Blessed are the poor in spirit. Yours is the kingdom. You who mourn, you will be comforted. You are blessed. Blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness. You will be filled. You see? Get the notion? So vitally, critically, 2 Samuel says, Then David went in and sat before the Lord. David sat. Scholar Eugene Peterson says this may be the single most critical act that David ever did, the action that put him out of the action. More critical than all the events before, even the ones we've reviewed, you know, this summer, more critical than killing Goliath, more critical than honoring Saul, his enemy when he died, who was God's anointed, more critical than bringing the ark to Jerusalem, because David now does, in response to Nathan's counsel, something that will either qualify him or disqualify him from the king work for which he has been anointed and trained and preserved and empowered and brought to this place. You know, it's all jeopardized. Again, you wouldn't think to look at him. It doesn't feel that way to him. He's in his prime in body and mind and spirit. He's been tested and matured. He's invested with the trust and the admiration of the people. He's grateful to God for all that God has given him. Isn't that what you want? Isn't that what God wants? Now he is King David, crowned and enthroned, energetically ambitious to do something for God. And now that he is king, the question is, will he be the kind of king that God has brought him to this place to be, or will he be the kind of king like Syria or like Egypt? Will he be tyrannical and imposing his will? Will he become proud and assert his domination over his inferiors? Most of all, will he view God, the God who made him to be king, as just his adjunct to his royal office, as indeed King Saul did? Or will David somehow come to realize anew his humanity, his blessed but real humanity and common humanity, and represent and give witness to God the King, the sovereign God, God Almighty? David sat before God. The whole idea is, by sitting down, he renounced his royal initiative. He took himself out of the driver's seat. And he deliberately and reverently placed him before God, his king. Consider this. Sometimes what we don't do for God is far more critical than, in fact, what we do. Now, I know modern Christians are characteristically afraid of being caught out doing too little for God, let alone nothing. But there are moments far more frequent than we suppose when doing nothing in this way is precisely the gospel thing to do. Now, this is not what I'm saying. Every once in a while you hear this old heresy, and it appears that distorts this worshipfully obedient nothing we're talking about today into some kind of ill-conceived or irresponsible nothing doing. I think you know what I'm talking about. And wrong-headed people emerge from time to time telling us that since God does everything, we must train ourselves to do nothing. We must cultivate a kind of pious sloth, I think is what they're saying. The less we do for God, the more God can do for us. That's not it. And still others counsel us to stoically resign ourselves to whatever happens, since whatever happens is the will of God. That's not it. When David sat down before God, it was the farthest thing from passivity, the farthest thing from resignation. If I can draw a parallel, it was no more passive than assuming a succession of yoga poses. It's only if you've never tried yoga, especially in your middle age or older, that you think that that's passive. Right, Carolyn? Yes. It's not passive. It was not passive. It was prayer. It was entering into the presence of God, becoming aware of God's word, trading in his plans for God's plans. It was letting his enthusiasm for being a king with the authority and strength to do just damn well what he pleased, to let that be replaced with the willingness to become a king who would represent truly the sovereignty of the King, the God Most High. And David sat before God and he prayed. And his prayer shows how well he listened to what God had preached to him through Nathan. As it shows up first that instead of announcing what he'll do for God, he addresses God as the one who has done and is doing things for him. You go on and read the prayer, it follows that. One key verse that comes out of that is this radical reversal. For you, O Lord of hosts, the King, the God of Israel, have made this revelation to your servant, saying, I will build you a house. Therefore, your servant has found courage to pray this prayer to you. And courage it takes, immense courage, to relinquish control, to resign our recently acquired prestigious positions, to quit our projects, or at least to let them be amended, and simply sit at Jesus' feet. God's message to him through Nathan came to him in the first person. God was the subject. That's always the first key. Whenever you wonder, God was the subject. The message proclaimed God's action. David listened, he sat down, and the real action started. Not David making God a house, but God making David a house. Now, let me say this here at the end, in case you're wondering. There is no danger, absolutely none, that in such action we'll end up doing nothing, we'll have nothing to do. I mean, David did much before he sat down, and he did much afterward. God commands and we obey. God sends and we go. I mean, that's just the way it is. Throughout our lives, it's been that way for centuries, God and God's people. And the Christian life is a gloriously active life as the Holy Spirit does the work of Christ in and through us. No, there's no danger that as we sit before the Lord that our legs will atrophy and we'll never be able to get up again. But there is great danger in getting so caught up in our plans, even our plans for God, that we forget all about God. The whole history of Israel, I mean, was held in the balance in those 2 days. Nathan went back to David the next morning, and David heard Nathan and turned to God and made God the subject. Make no mistake, the story of our lives hang in the balance in the same way. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.